Welcome. It is my pleasure to present the poster titled Mutagenic Impurities from a Drug Substance Perspective, highlights from the ICH M7 question and answer draft document. The purpose of this poster is to highlight specific questions from the ICH M7 Q&A document regarding when a total mutagenic impurity limit is applicable, when is it appropriate to use an option 4 strategy. I will present two scenarios that address different aspects of this question. Is test data for potential mutagenic impurity that is consistently less than 30% TTC in multiple batches sufficient to justify no testing of that impurity in the control strategy? And finally, is periodic verification testing, i.e. skip testing, allowed for option 2 and 3 control? Before proceeding, I would like to give a brief background on ICH M7. ICH M7 assessment and control of DNA reactive mutagenic impurities in pharmaceuticals to limit potential carcinogenic risk guidance reached step 4 in June of 2014. This guidance for the first time outlined a variety of approaches to control potential mutagenic impurities, PMIs, based on the maximum daily dose, duration of use, and indication of the drug product. The limit to which a PMI is controlled based on these factors is defined as a threshold of toxicological concern, or TTC. An addendum document with compound-specific acceptable intakes reached step 4 in May of 2017. Since implementation of the ICH M7 guidance, there has been some confusion with regards to how some of the approaches outlined in the guidance have been interpreted. To help to address any confusion in the ICH M7 guidance, ICH developed a question and answer document. This document at the time of this recording is in step 2B of the revision process, with public comment phase completed and questions being addressed by the ICH expert working group. First, it is important to note what does not fall under the scope of M7. M7 is not intended for the following types of drug substance and drug products: biological, biotechnological, peptides, oligonucleotides, radiopharmaceutical, fermentation, herbal, and crude products of animal or plant origin. Excipients used in existing marketing products, flavoring agents, colorants, and perfumes. Leachables associated with drug product packaging. APIs intended to be used for advanced cancer. APIs that are genotoxic at therapeutic concentrations. And finally, already approved products unless there are changes to the drug substance synthesis resulting in new impurities or increased acceptance criteria for existing impurities. Changes in the formulation, composition, or manufacturing process resulting in new degradation products or increased acceptance criteria for existing degradation products. Changes in indication or dosing regime are made which significantly affect the acceptable cancer risk level. The first topic I would like to address is the total mutagenic impurity limit. The TTC-based acceptable intakes should be applied to each individual impurity. When there are two class 2 or class 3 impurities, individual limits apply. When there are three or more class 2 or class 3 impurities specified on the drug substance specification, total mutagenic impurity should be limited as described in Table 3 below for clinical development and marketed products. For combination products, each active ingredient should be regulated separately. Only specified class 2 and class 3 impurities on the drug substance specification are included in the calculation of total limit. However, impurities with compound-specific or class-related acceptable intake limits, i.e. class 1, should be not included in the total limits of class 2 and class 3 impurities. Also, degradation products which form in the drug product would be controlled individually and a total limit would not be applied. When is it appropriate to use an option 4 control strategy? The appropriate use of option 4 depends on when the potential mutagenic impurity is introduced or generated in the synthesis. To address this question, we have two scenarios. The first is when a PMI is introduced early in the synthesis, as outlined in the red box here. When a potential mutagenic impurity is introduced early in the synthesis, before the last synthetic step, then the use of option 4 can be appropriate when a mutagenic impurity is demonstrated to have a negligible risk of being present in the final drug substance, i.e. less than or equal to 1% TTC. The risk assessment can be based on scientific principles alone, calculated purge factors, measured purge factors, or a combination of these approaches, considering the process-relevant conditions. The acceptability of the option 4 will be assessed by authorities on a case-by-case basis. In the second scenario, the PMI is introduced or generated in the last synthetic step, as outlined in the red box in the synthetic scheme here. For potential mutagenic impurities introduced or generated in the last synthetic step, given the proximity to the final product, option 1 is the preferred control strategy. However, option 2 and option 3 control strategies may be possible, for example, when the crude drug substance is an isolated material which is purified subsequently, i.e. by recrystallization. An option 4 control strategy for an impurity introduced or generated in the last synthetic step is discouraged and should be reserved for highly reactive species, for example, thionyl chloride, or materials with low boiling point, i.e. methyl chloride. In case of highly effective purification operations such as chromatography, an option 4 control approach may also be acceptable for less reactive materials. However, in such cases, negligible risk of an impurity to be carried to the final product, i.e. less than or equal to 1% TTC, should be justified with experimental data. A justification solely based on calculations is not considered sufficient. Is test data for a potential mutagenic impurity that is consistently less than 30% TTC in multiple batches sufficient to justify no testing of that impurity in the control strategy? No. Batch data alone demonstrating that a potential mutagenic impurity is consistently less than 30% TTC is not sufficient to justify no testing of that impurity. Control options 1, 2, or 3 should be utilized to test either at release or upstream in the process. Per ICHM-7, if the option 3 control strategy, upstream control, is chosen, then two conditions should be met to justify this control strategy. A spike purge experiment at the proposed limit from laboratory scale experiments and where necessary supported by data from pilot scale or commercial scale batches should be provided. In addition, data from multiple batches which is consistently less than 30% TTC should also be provided. However, if there is negligible risk of the impurity to be present in the drug substance, an option 4 control strategy may be considered with appropriate justifications. Is periodic verification testing, i.e. skip testing, allowed for option 2 and option 3 control? No, periodic verification testing is not appropriate for option 2 and option 3 control. Periodic verification testing is only discussed as a control strategy for option 1 control in section 8.1 of ICHM-7. The option 1 periodic verification testing strategy references ICHQ-6A. The option 1 periodic verification testing concept per ICHQ-6A should generally be implemented post-approval and applies to testing in the final drug substance. In conclusion, since implementation, there has been some confusion with regards to how some of the approaches outlined in the guidance have been interpreted. The ICHM-7 assessment and control of DNA reactive mutagenic impurities in pharmaceuticals to limit potential carcinogenic risk question and answer document now in step 2 addresses the confusion regarding the interpretation of various sections of the original ICHM-7 guidance. This poster defined what is not in the scope of the ICHM-7 guidance and highlighted four sections covered in the new ICHM-7 question and answer document of particular concern to the agency. Total mutagenic impurity limits, appropriate use of the option 4 control strategies, two scenarios were discussed, batch test data less than 30% TTC and the appropriate use of spike purge studies, and finally, periodic verification testing. The topics we highlighted demonstrate that the new ICHM-7 question and answer document gives clear guidance for industry on how to fully implement the ICHM-7 assessment and control of DNA reactive mutagenic impurities in pharmaceuticals to limit potential carcinogenic risk guidance. Before I conclude, I quickly want to address supporting data expectations specifically for spike purge studies and option 4 purge calculations. Spike purge studies should include the batch size of the laboratory scale experiment, the proposed limit of the PMI, complete analytical method information, including LOD and LOQ, as well as a results table. The option 4 calculation should be detailed and follow the format outlined by Teasdale et al. In the paper referenced here. Any supporting literature used to justify purge factors should be submitted with the calculations. Finally, the ICHM-7 guidance and supporting documents can be found on the ICH website. This concludes my presentation. Please submit questions using the link provided on the workshop poster page next to this poster. That will send an email to us at this email address listed here. Please submit your questions by February 15, 2021 for inclusion in the poster Q&A session on March 4th. A follow-on webinar for both posters and presentations will be on April 9th. Questions can be sent to the above email by March 19th for the webinar. For additional information on impurity acceptance criteria, impurity qualifications, and the ICHM-7 guidance, I encourage you to view the poster and presentations on March 3rd and 4th listed here. Thank you for listening.